What is the point of getting married?
To grow, to have a family,
What does the Torah say? What is the first statement or instruction about marriage in the Torah?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Actually, Pru Revu was also said to animals. What does it say about marriage? So if you take a look in Bereishis, the Eibishter that created Adam, male and female. Zohar on the cave of Bara Isay. Then the Eibishter separated them. And right after separating them, the Eibishter said, Al Kain, Yazev Ish es Oviv es Imei, a man should leave his mother and father, V'dovak b'ishtei, cleave to his wife, V'hoyu l'bosar echad, and they should become one flesh. That is the first statement about marriage. And it doesn't say Pru Revu. It's talking about the husband and the wife before there's a baby. So marriage is not for the baby. Marriage is for husband and wife. And that happens to be the best way to have a baby. But what does it mean, Al Kain? What is it connected to? The Eibishter separates Adam and Chava and says, therefore, what's therefore? By nature, Adam and Chava should be one person. They shouldn't be two people. How do we know? Because that's how he was created. So first the Eibishter creates Adam, male and female, then he separates them. So what's their nature?
To be one.
To be one. The separation is artificial, unnatural. By the way, every separation is unnatural. The Eibishter is Achdus. Hashem Echad. As soon as you have separation, it's already not natural.
Maybe it wasn't supposed to be together in the first place.
So he created them wrong and then fixed it?
No, maybe they just weren't meant for one another. It wasn't natural for them to be together. Or two things to be together. So a separation was necessary.
Right, so that would mean that the Eibishter created them wrong and then fixed it.
No, just you thought it was wrong.
He thought it was wrong because he fixed it. See, nothing else in creation was that way. Everything that the Eibishter created in the 6 days of creation, that's how it was supposed to be. So the animals were animals, trees were trees, everything was, but the human being, they got created together, and that's not good, you have to fix it.
Why would you put them together in the first place if you knew he had to separate?
Right. So again,
well, didn't he create Chava because he knew that it wouldn't be good for Adam to be alone?
Yeah.
So that's why he created them.
But why didn't he create it that way in the first place?
Why did he make a separation?
Why a separation? Right. So I mean, the separation was like an operation. Why would you need an operation? Create it the right way to begin with.
Right.
So we usually think Adam was male and female? That's creepy. That's weird.
Was it like on one side and one side? Like how was it?
I don't know. Let me try.
Don't think about it.
Let's not draw any pictures here.
I'm trying to imagine.
Right. But it's definitely weird, right? So then when the Eibishter separated them, it's like, oh, whew. Okay, now we're normal. That's not correct. The way the Eibishter created Adam, that's the way it's supposed to be. Separation? Not natural. So here's what the Eibishter says. You're supposed to be one, but I just separated you. So, therefore, Al Cain, get married so that you become one again.
Doesn't that seem a bit like a roundabout way? Yeah. Like, put you together, then I'll separate you so you can be together again. Like one.
Exactly right. Exactly right. We have the same question with the Eibishter. You are a piece of the Eibishter. He separates you, sends you into this world. For what purpose?
To
become one with him. Like, hello? So obviously, being one is fantastic. And the Eibishter wants to give us credit for being one. That we should be one through our own bechira. But this tells us so much about nature. What do men and women need from each other?
Support. Well, it depends on what context.
You ask anybody, ask any guy in the street. What is the attraction of men to women and women to men?
We'll never understand what men to women, but we can know what women to men.
If you ask people in the street, what's the answer going to be?
Physical. Desire to be with each other.
Mm-hmm. Sex. It's not the right answer. It's not the right answer.
What else should they know? What else should they know that they're beautiful inside on the end? No,
you got
that's
to know that
mean.
Person.
Well, it's woman. They're
but
even
the thing
more
is,
emotional.
No, more emotional. Yeah. Involved.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's just like, yeah.
No. There's like first love at first sight that like you just like know that you're meant to be with each other.
But think clearly.
You got to know that.
What else can you expect from men?
Wait. So think clearly. The question is, what do men need women for? If you say sex, it's not the right answer. For sex, you don't need a man and a woman. Two men, two women. You don't need a man and a woman. I'm not asking you what a man and a woman can do. I'm asking, what is it that a man needs from a woman? Men and women need each other to feel complete, to be whole, which means to be healthy. If a man doesn't feel that need, then he's not healthy. If a woman doesn't feel that need, not healthy. So feeling the lack is the most natural thing in the world. You're missing another half of yourself. How can you not feel that there's something missing? Unless you're numb or distracted or something. But naturally, you should feel that need. Marriage means becoming whole by becoming one with each other. Why does that make us whole? Because a human being is male and female. Only the Eibishter wants that we should become whole through our own efforts. In order for that to be possible, how can two people become one? The answer is, it's your nature to be one. If we had not been created one, then there's no way that you can make yourself one unnaturally. But because we were created as one, which means that is our true nature. That's why it is possible through marriage to become one again. Put it another way. How do husband and wife become one? What do they do to become one? They eat together? They have one checkbook. They share all the money. They sleep in the same bed. How do you become one? None of those things would make you one. It's two people doing something together. They're still two people. If separation is unnatural and oneness is natural, how do you become one? What do you need to do to become one? You don't need to do anything. You need to stop doing something. Something is separating you. Well, stop doing that.
What is it?
In other words, since your nature is to be one, something has to be separating you unnaturally. Get rid of that thing, and what's the result?
Oneness.
If you're not separating, then you're one. So to become one, it's not what you do, it's what you don't do. Stop creating separation, and you'll naturally be one.
Stop creating creation.
What separates us? What keeps us separate? Something. Something. So here's the key. There are things, objects, and there are human beings. A human being is not an object. A human being is not a thing. In fact, you're not allowed to treat a person like an object. That's hurtful, it's painful, it's disrespectful, it's abuse. If you treat a person like a thing, it's abuse. Like the first time I heard a man say, I'm getting divorced. I've had it. I don't need this. I'd never heard that expression before. And I was really like, whoa, you don't need this? You're divorcing her. Because you don't need this? Something didn't make any sense. If you don't need this, get rid of this. Why are you getting rid of her? Which actually shows he never connected to her. There was no her. There was an it. And now he doesn't want it. He doesn't need this. What about her? What's her? To him, marriage was a thing to do. It wasn't about her. She was a thing in his life. He doesn't need this anymore. So he says, you think we should get divorced? Well, you are divorced. You never really got married. Maybe you should think of getting married. So the mental approach to marriage has become very unnatural. We don't think of the other person as a person. We think of the other person as something in my life. We think of another person as a body, not as a person. And a body is a thing. It's a thing. It's not a person. So, what keeps two people separate? Not their human part. Their physical part. Things. So if a man marries a woman for her body, It's not even a marriage. Because he's not connecting to her. He's connecting to something that she has. A body. And not really to her whole body. He's not interested in her whole body. He's interested only in certain parts of the body. Things. When he gets tired with things, the marriage is over. How long does it take to get bored with things?
Pretty fast.
Sometimes it starts off that way.
Bored? It starts off bored?
No, it starts off with liking the body,
and then eventually, sometimes.
You can't. Don't take that. What do you expect? Like, what do you
just
expect?
But
there's another danger, which is the opposite. It starts off with two people really liking each other, but then they get into the physical relationship, and all of a sudden, forget the other person. I'm just interested in something.
But how can you forget about that part and then just switch into...
Unfortunately, one of the reasons that that happens is because you see the body. In other words, notsnius. If you see the body, you can very easily get focused on that and you forget the person whose body it is.
Do you think that that's why Jewish people, like, our marriages work out so much better than not-Jewish people, just because we keep that, like, aside? Like, when we go date and stuff for marriage, we get to know the person, not the body.
And even after you're married, there are laws of tznius and there's mikveh. You can't so easily switch to the object.
It's really good opportunity.
Yeah. So here's a summary of what we're saying. It is way too common that a man loves his wife because of something. That's a disaster. There is something about her that he loves. That's it. This is the beginning of the end. And it's a little bit confusing because when you're dating, what are you looking at? Yeah.
You're looking at the things that you like.
And like, what are you supposed to know? Like,
exactly.
How do you know if you're being blinded by...
things.
Exactly.
Right. But that's the way you date. That's the right way to date. When you go on a date, what are you looking for? Things. You actually have a list. The problem is, when you're dating, you are looking for things. That's all you can. That's all you can see. That's all you can know. If all the things fit, then you marry him. You don't marry the things. People forget to make that adjustment. They like everything about him, so they marry those things. That's terrible.
So how do you make sure to not...
What's
him? That's a very good question. How many times have you felt that your mother doesn't love you for you? She just loves you for things.
Never.
Never?
No. Everything I have is hers. Like, what?
No, but that thing, that feeling about, can't you just accept me the way I am? What does that mean? Accept you for who you are. Who are you? Look, I'm ugly, and I'm unfriendly, and I'm whatever. But accept me the way I am. Excuse me, but the way you are is ugly and unfriendly. Why would I accept that? No, don't accept that. Accept me.
which is ugly and unfriendly.
No. Those are the things about me.
About that person, but it's not that.
But that's all you see. Like, if someone's mean to you, you're not going to say, oh, but I'm sure she has a good soul.
Exactly. That's all you see. The eye only sees things. But you cannot connect to another person by looking at them.
It always starts off that way.
It does.
Because listen, when you're going out on a date, why you get dressed?
Why do you say
look
nice?
Yeah, not come and look like.
Yeah, it's because it's just how it is. Like, first he's looking at those things,
and then you develop into something deeper.
Exactly. Or you forget to develop into something deeper, right. And you're just
that's
left with.
Thing, but
that's a problem.
How can we depend on that?
We're still depending
for
on
a woman. A woman's nature is more to like look at that person more than the things. But for a man, it's more their first things. It's more of the things. So how do we?
And we know that. That's why we go there.
That's why.
Nicely.
That's why women need to beat sneers more than men.
I think that will change their outlook.
No, it's definitely going to help it out.
It forces them.
Yeah, to look at.
You don't have
that person more than the thing.
Actually, it forces them to listen rather than look. This guy from a conservative temple told me an interesting thing. He says, you know, we have a woman rabbi. And I'm okay with that. He says, But I did notice a difference. When we got a new rabbi who was a man, everybody went around talking about, have you heard the new rabbi? We got a new rabbi who's a woman. Everybody walks around saying, have you seen the new rabbi? There's seeing only involves things, because that's all the eye can see. Tznius means, don't see me, hear me. When you hear somebody, you're not hearing something. You're hearing the person. So here's the summary of it. Nothing about your husband is more important than your husband. Nothing you get from your husband is more important than your husband. Because you're connected to him, not something you get from him. Because what you get from him, you can get from anybody else just as easily. What, your husband is going to give you something that nobody else can give you? Come on. A man says, I'm getting married to this woman. She is the most beautiful woman in the world. Really?
Well, in his eyes, she is.
And what are you going to say when you meet another woman who is more beautiful? That's it? You're divorced? You see?
Okay.
If you're connecting to the person, yeah, she's beautiful. And if she wasn't beautiful? Wouldn't make any difference because I'm connected to her. So, for example, you want love from your husband. Yeah? You want your husband to love you. Why? A woman who feels that her husband doesn't love her is miserable. Why? Why? If you need love, then you shouldn't have gotten married. If you need love, go home to your mother. Your mother will love you.
It's not the same love that you want.
Why?
Because your connection with your husband is something more
intense.
It's like a deep love. It's like a different type of love. It's not something that nobody else could give you, not even your mother, not even your siblings.
But any man could be your husband.
But not any man will love you.
Any man will love you.
If you're lovable, anybody's going to love you.
Not in the way you want.
Okay, so here's the thing. when you get married, it's because you need him in your life. You need him to love you. You don't need love. You didn't marry love. You married him. So what do you need?
Him to love.
Him.
Well, you need him to love you.
Ah, you need him, not you need him to love you. You need him. How do you have him? 1,000 different ways. You have him because he thinks about you. You have him because he lives in your house. You have him because he loves you. But it's his love you want, not love. You don't need love, you need him. When he loves you, you have him. If he doesn't love you, you still have him. But that love that you want from him, you can't get from anybody else. You can't get his love from somebody else. Just like you can't get your mother's love from some other woman. So if you need love, you're not ready to get married.
You need his love
then. Why do you need his love?
You want him.
Because he's your husband. In other words, you need his love only after you're married.
So how do you explain the one, like, I love, like, when a Kala or like a groom says they love her, I love him.
They don't know what love is. It's like, yeah.
But still, it's
so
like,
far you're just loving things. You're not loving him.
Is it always like that though in the beginning?
Yeah, people say that after 5 years of marriage, yeah. Then you'll love.
You fall in love. You're always gonna fall in love. Like you're not in love with the person. You're gonna learn to love them.
You'll finally know what love is after like a couple of years.
Because you're moving away from the things.
And you're developing something.
To the person.
So how come if it's so bad to be attracted to the things, and why is the basis of the marriage? Yeah, why is the basis?
Okay, so. Look at Yiddishkeit. How do we relate to the Eibishter? The Eibishter is Melech al kol ha'olam. He is Melech malchei hamlochim. He is Kol Yochel. He is Chesed and he is Gvura and he is so many things. Awesome. He is holy. He is infinite. Nice things, but those are things. The Alter Rebbe said, Ich will nicht dein Gan Eden. What does that mean? I don't want your Gan Eden. I don't want your heaven. I just want you. But you have to be careful with the words. I don't want your Gan Eden. I don't want Gan Eden. Well, that's obvious. You're having a relationship with Eibishter, not with Gan Eden. But what is Gan Eden? Gan Eden is his Gan Eden. It's something about him. When the Alter Rebbe said, it is something about you, but that's not what I want. I don't want things about you. I just want you. So we start off with things about him. I mean, where did we get this notion of Gan Eden? And why do some people want Gan Eden? Because it's something about the Eibishter that we like, which is fine. But then you got to grow up. Get past the things about him, get to him. had a really interesting conversation with this non-Jew. And he had no idea what the difference is between Jews and non-Jews. He couldn't figure it out. Like, what's your problem? We have a Savior, the Messiah. He comes, he forgives you for your sin. What's your problem? Didn't get it, right? So I said to him, you believe that the only way to the Father is through him, through the Son. Okay. So have you gotten to the Father yet? The way to the Father is through the Son. Okay, we don't believe that.
Why do you believe in the Hashem and the Rebbe? That could be the same thing.
No, no. Your objective is to get to Hashem.
Okay.
Whatever helps you get there is fine.
So what?
So people ask the Father is the Son.
We just
right, no, so.
In Rebbe class, whatever, the Shiach class. And she literally believes that the only way to get to God is through the Rebbe. That's like literally believing in.
It's also true that the only way to get to the Eibishter is through mitzvahs.
Okay, but that's not that's going to someone.
We're talking about a person.
The
Rebbe
is a person.
Is a person that is not.
So a person is less holy than a mitzvah?
No, it's not.
We could just say we can't say that it's Hashem. Hashem's mitzvah, the mitzvah is Hashem's.
And what is a tzaddik?
It's not Hashem's.
What?
It's not Hashem's. Hashem, it's not the tzaddik. Is not Hashem.
If that were true, then we would not believe in a tzaddik.
Everything has something.
Everything in this world belongs to God.
You know what? Every Jew is a part of Hashem. So why don't we believe in every single Jew?
Excuse me.
Believe in every Jew.
We do.
We do believe in every Jew, but then there's some Jews that are greater than other Jews. But I still think that some people have a whole.
Look, what's greater, a mitzvah or a chelak alakamimal?
They're both the same because they're part of Hashem.
So if you have a person who is a chelak alakamimal and nothing else, that's a tzaddik.
Yeah, but shouldn't you strive to not have to go through someone and be?
Yeah, but we can never be there.
Whether you have to go through someone or not,
well, what is your goal?
Wait.
You got to go through Rebbe if you want to.
The question is not how to get there. The question is, where do you want to get?
You want to get to the ultimate.
Exactly. So what happens when the Rebbe inspires you? What do?
You get closer.
You buy him a gift? You get closer to what?
You get closer to him. To where you want to go.
Yeah.
Is Hashem.
Connect to him more. That's connected to Hashem. Yeah.
People who are inspired by the Rebbe suddenly decide to keep Shabbos. For the Rebbe?
No, but...
People who are inspired by the Rebbe suddenly decide to keep kosher.
But they thank the Rebbe for it.
Fine.
That it was the Rebbe who made them do that.
Maybe.
But it's really awful. They're forgetting that they're... It's like, let's say they need someone in their life. They're like, hey, I'm going to go to the aisle and daven. They say daven to Hashem, but really they're davening to the Rebbe.
Yeah. Well, what are they asking for?
Shouldn't you daven straight to God?
That's
where
not
is
the
God in this world?
That's not the issue. The issue is, what are you asking for?
You're asking for something that you need in your personal life.
From
Hashem. You need it from Hashem.
Exactly.
Right, but
hey,
and when something happens, they're like, the Rebbe helped me. The Rebbe did this for me. Hashem did that for you. It was God.
So if you think that they're two separate entities, then you're right.
Yeah,
but the only reason we believe in a tzaddik is because he's not something separate.
They are separate.
Then it's a big mistake.
So that means the Rebbe is Hashem?
Their partner is the Rebbe and God?
Or is it the Son of God? Like, what is it? Like, what do you
think?
The Rebbe is Hashem.
No one could be on the. No one could be partners with God.
The Rebbe is not Hashem.
No one could be partners with God.
You're a partner with God.
Yeah,
you're just not a good partner.
I'm a servant of God.
You're just not doing a good job.
Servants. There's a difference between a partner and a servant.
Right. A Beinoni is a servant. A Tzaddik is a partner. So again, the question is, let's say every method is fine. But a method to what? So I ask the Christian, your approach to God is through him. So if he connects you to God, then what happens?
That we do.
When he connects you to God, then what happens? Then you go to heaven. One second. How did you get connected to God? What would it mean that he connected you to God and now you're connected to God? Now, what happens? You go to heaven. That's what it is. When he connects you to God, you die. Go to heaven. In Yiddishkeit, if somebody connects you to God, then you do his mitzvahs. Then you serve him. So I said to this guy, he's been connecting you for 2,000 years. It's time to get connected already. Move on. Or it's not working. He's connecting you, connecting you, connecting. You're not getting there.
So are we.
Because they gave up on mitzvahs.
I mean, it's a miracle that we're still connected.
I'm talking about them.
So are we. Many Jews
gave up on mitzvahs.
Because they're not connected.
Because they're not getting anywhere.
So we're connected if we do Hashem's mitzvahs?
Of course.
So we're already connected because we're doing Hashem's mitzvahs?
Yes. Every mitzvah you do is a connection directly to him. Why are you doing a mitzvah? Because he wants. So if you don't get to serve him, then you're not getting anywhere. So to say he connects you to God, no, he's not. Because there's nothing to do for God. They gave up on mitzvahs. So if the Ebershter doesn't need your mitzvahs, then how are you going to connect to him? By going to heaven? So again, sticking to the theme, I just want you. Yes, Gan Eden is godly, and it's next to God, and it's the beauty of God.
It's a result of God. It's like a result of like you connecting to God.
But that's not what I want. I want you, not your best thing. I just want you.
To use a painful
example, a woman is married to a guy. And he gets sick, and he becomes completely paralyzed, completely unfunctional. And he's that way for like 10 years. And after 10 years, he dies. And the woman is grieving. And you come to her and you say, what, you're upset that he died? What did you lose? What were you getting from him? He's completely... So you say, what have you been getting for 10 years? What have you gotten from him? Her answer is,
got him.
What did I get from him?
His love.
Nothing.
You have his.
I wasn't getting anything from him.
Anything.
But I had him. Now I don't have him.
But does that include his love?
Yeah. So, you know Fiddler on the Roof? You know the songs from Fiddler on the Roof? So, Tevye asks his wife, do you love me? Remember? Why did he ask her that? After being married for 25 years? Huh?
Because love is meant to come by the 25 years. Oh, because so many years passed and like they went through so much.
He's asking, do you have me? Do you love him, the person? Not all the things I do for you.
Right. So if you look, put it in the context of the story, his daughters refused to marry who he chose. Because they want to marry someone they love. And this was like, whoa, yeah. New idea. Never heard of such a thing.
Was enlightened to what, that there is love.
So now he comes to his wife and says, by the way, Do you love me? And what does she say?
At first she's like,
I do all this
25 years, years and then doing this and all. And at the end she's
but
like,
but he keeps
yeah,
saying, do you love, me? Do you love not the things, like, do you love me? And
so yeah, I guess I do.
So it sounds like they're making fun of her. She is so naive, she's so old-fashioned, she doesn't even know what love is, right? Because when he says, do you love me, she says, do I what? See, she's so primitive. That's not the point of the story. The opposite. He says, do you love me? She says, what? Where is this question coming from? He says, do you love me? She's basically asking, are you giving me your love? Am I getting love from you? What does she say? She says, for 25 years, I am yours. When did you become a baby all of a sudden? You want love? Are you a teenager? You have me. All of me. All you're worried about is love? Grow up. In other words, you're asking about something, and I'm telling you, you have me. Not just one thing from me, which is love.
It's like not love is the only thing I could give you. I could give you me.
And me is not a thing. So,
what is love as a thing?
Huh?
So are you saying that love is a thing?
Sure. Sure.
How is it a thing though? It's like,
well, because you can have love, not have love. You can have more love, less love. This kind of love, that kind of love. It's a thing. So, let's get back to the oneness. How do two people become one? You become one when you can remove everything about yourself and him. If you get things out of the way, that's it, you're one. Because if there's no thing between you, if there's nothing between you, guess what? If there's nothing between you, then you're one. The only reason you're two is because of something. And love can be that thing. Sex can be that thing. If you can get past all things and you just are thrilled to have him, then you're one.
Yeah, but you don't get rid of those things. It's still there, yeah?
No, but it's not what's making it.
I know,
but
I'm saying
it's not what's
still
making
there.
You excited about
it's still
it.
There.
It's not, of course, it's not about his things. You're excited about him.
So, what happens in the bedroom, husband and wife? What happens? Nothing. As soon as you start to think that there's something going on there, you're destroying the marriage. So maybe in other areas and other times of your life, of course, things are important. Does he make a living? It's kind of important. It's something that you need. But in the bedroom, nothing. Nothing. It's just them. Who's a thing? She's not a thing. He's not a thing. What? So when it's just them, that's called becoming one. When the Alter Rebbe says, I don't want Gan Eden, I just want you, that's called Achdus. Yichud. How does it happen? Not by what you do, it's by what I don't want. I don't want Gan Eden. The result is, I have you. And what does it mean, I have you? Just be in my life. Be in my life. And do what? That's not important. Again, it's the same thing as mitzvahs. People keep Shabbos. And they're very, very careful. They're Shomer Shabbos. And they eat cholent like it's... What are you doing? What are you doing? You need Shabbos? Like you need Gan Eden? If Shabbos is your thing, then you're not connected to the Eibishter. You want to be connected to Him. How do you do it? Shabbos. Kasher. But if Shabbos becomes its own thing, you've just ruined your relationship. That's why there's that famous expression, a chassid worships the Eibishter, a misnagid worships the Shulchan Aruch. What's a Shulchan Aruch? So what's so terrible? You're worshiping one of God's things.
We don't need his things.
So what's so terrible about worshiping the sun? It's one of God's things.
Just things.
Yeah, and it's sun is compared to a tzaddik, so you don't need one of his things.
Of course. If tzaddik is your thing,
that's a big problem.
Then it's terrible. It's like some people who have this fantastic emunah in tzaddikim, and they run to every grave and to every cave and to every, and they're not frum at all. Like, what is that? They have this thing. It's not the Eibishter.
But you're doing things for the Eibishter and trying to be connected to Him. You're doing things for Him. So it's like He's loving your things. So how do you not love His things?
No, He's loving you for doing His things.
No, He's loving you as you.
No, He's loving you as well by doing His things.
He wants you to keep Shabbos so that He has you, not that He has Shabbos.
So can we want our husband to do things for us so we could have him?
It's the only way. In other words, I don't want love from you. I want your love. Like with your children. You want your children to love you? Why? You're lonely? You need love? And you want to get it from children? That's weird. You don't need love from your children.
You want your children's love.
You want your children's love. Why? Because you want them, not because you want love. So don't make the means into an end. And that's called Lifnim Mishuras Hadin. A chassid is somebody who goes Lifnim Mishuras Hadin. What does that mean, Lifnim Mishuras Hadin? You put two mezuzahs on your door? You shake two lulavs? How do you go lifnim mishuras hadin?
What does that mean? What's the translation?
Beyond the letter of the law. Beyond the letter of the law is a sin. You put two mezuzahs on your door, it's a sin.
You realize that you're not just doing the law for, you're doing it to get to Hashem.
Because what is before the law? The lawgiver. What's before the mitzvah? The mitzvah. Whose mitzvah? So being a chassid means I'm not keeping Shabbos for Shabbos. I'm keeping Shabbos for the Eibishter. I'm keeping Shabbos because of who gave it to me, not because of what it is.
So
Wow, a day of rest. I love this. That's not Shabbos. That can be Tuesday also. So again, what is marriage? Marriage means the ability to grow and rise past all things and just connect to another mensch. Your mensch to his mensch. Those are not things. That can be one. Two things will never be one. A thing is a thing. It's never going to become one with another thing. But two people can become one. And that's why it is our true nature to be one. It's unnatural for two neshamas to be separate. What separated you? You're both neshamas. What's separating you? Something? Well, get that thing out of the way.
Yeah, but how do you ensure that you're one? You could be marrying one person.
That's the Eberster's business.
Like when you're dating, what are you ensuring that you see?
What you need to find out through dating is whether this person feels so right to you that you hope he's the one. That's all you can do. When you're married to him, now you know he is the one. But what you need to discover is whether you want him to be
the one.
If he doesn't marry you, well, he wasn't the one. If he does marry you, he's the one. But for some, huh?
But if you don't want him, you're not the one.
Why are you marrying him?
Exactly, you're not going to marry him.
If you're not, of course you don't. Then he's not going to be the one.
But you can make him the one.
But it also happens so often. No.
What happens so often?
It happens so often that you go out with some guy, and you don't like him. You say no. 4 months later, it's like, okay, we'll try it again, and you marry him. So what happened the first time? See, we don't know. We're trying our best. But the outcome will always be what the Eibishter wants. You will always marry the one. Even if you say no a few times, it's going to keep coming back because you're going to marry the one.
You could have
a few. No. Oh, you mean?
Get married, get divorced, yeah. Your husband,
yeah.
God forbid, dies.
Yeah. But each time there was only one. In other words, you couldn't marry your second husband.
At the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Because then it wouldn't work out.
Yeah. At that time, he was not the one.
Is it the same thing with also, like, the time that you get married? Like some people that get married, like, so, like, when they're older, like, were they not, is it because they were not ready for that person? Like, what is it?
Don't know. But there can only be one, and it can only happen at a certain time. There are no mistakes. Obviously, there are certain things that the Eibishter never gives up. Never going to trust you to make the decision. Like whether you should have a baby or not. And the Eibishter is not going to let you decide. It's too big. It's too important. How can you make the decision? He always makes the decision. And the same with marriage. Who you're going to marry? What, the Eibishter is going to leave that to you? You got to be kidding. I should decide who's the one? How am I supposed to know? So he never abandons that. And interestingly, talking about the Rebbe and the Eibishter, after the Rebbetzin passed away, the Rebbe said, I can't deal with Gashmizdike things anymore. So if you have a question in business, ask your friends. If you have a question with health, ask your doctor who is your friend. And if you have a question with yeshiva, ask the Hanhola. Stop asking me. But he never said, stop asking me about Shidduchim.
That's the holy thing in the world.
The most important.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a pleasure.